Are you excited? Yeah? I'll do it again. Are you excited? Oké, dames en heren, geef hem dan een groot applaus. Shailin Lim, dames en heren, groot applaus.
Good afternoon, everyone. My talk is as follows. First, I will assert why philosophy matters. Then I will discuss the crypto-anarchist and cypherpunk philosophy. It will be followed by a description of the essence of blockchain. And I will also make a comparative analysis with the crypto-anarchist and cypherpunk philosophy. And finally, I will discuss what types of applications we can expect in the near future from the crypto space that adhere to this philosophy. So first of all, why does philosophy matter? Well, I believe that if we really want to understand the social and practical implications of blockchain, that we cannot dismiss the philosophy that gave birth to it. So if you look at the Bitcoin blockchain, the Bitcoin blockchain has been heavily influenced by this philosophy. It's a philosophy that seeks privacy, political freedom, and economic freedom through the use of cryptography. Cryptography is the science to conceal or to make information unintelligible. Therefore, the crypto anarchists and the cypherpunks, they created such applications as untraceable payments, untraceable email, and secure payments. Secure messaging. Timothy May, he was the founder of the cypherpunk movement, and he defines crypto anarchy as the cyberspatial realization of libertarian anarchism. And he says that for libertarians, strong crypto provides the means by which government will be avoided. Another famous cypherpunk member was Julian Assange. Assange, he wrote that all civilization has reached a crossroads. In one direction lies the future, promoting privacy for the weak and transparency for the powerful. Cypherpunks advocate the use of cryptography and similar methods as ways to achieve societal and political changes. So if we sum up what they wanted to achieve, we can say that they wanted to have transparency, especially transparency of governments. They are voluntarists. They believe that every social and economic interaction should be allowed as long as it happens on a voluntary basis. They are also strong advocates of privacy. They believe that everyone has the right to privacy. They believe in strict property rights. They are supporters of free markets, and they would like to eliminate the government monopoly over money production. And they are also supporters of decentralization of power. They believe that social order can happen from the ground up. Now, we know that. Let's look at the Bitcoin blockchain and compare it to traditional centralized databases. So what you see on the top, that's a traditional centralized network with a central server. A central server has a database, and the database has an administrator. This administrator, he can determine who can add what content. He can determine what content can be added on the database. He controls your password. He controls your username. And this is very prone for corruption, very prone for censorship. If you would like to break down this centralized network, all you need to do is corrupt the administrator, or you have to attack the central server on which the database is stored. Blockchain, in that sense, is radically different. Because within blockchain, you also have a database, but this database is distributed among a large network of computers. Every computer on this network has the exact same copy of this blockchain, and every computer also verifies every transaction, every mutation that happens on the blockchain. And if you would like to hack the blockchain, you would have to hack into all these different computers, or at least reach consensus among the majority of these computers that your corrupted data is the right data. Now let's compare the Bitcoin blockchain with the crypto anarchist and cypherpunk philosophy. The Bitcoin blockchain is also transparent. It's open source. Everyone can look into the code, and every transaction can be followed. It's also voluntarist. You are free to join the Bitcoin network. You are not coerced to join it. You're also free to leave it. And this is very different from the USD or the euro, where you are coerced to use the USD or the euro. You're used to use the national currencies. It's a big proponent of privacy. Anyone, anywhere, can create a Bitcoin wallet in 5 seconds. You don't have to provide any private information, and Bitcoin addresses are pseudonymous. They have strict property rights within blockchain. No one can take away Bitcoin from you as long as you have your own private key to which you have access to your Bitcoin wallet. It introduces competition into the industry of money production. And lastly, it is decentralized because the blockchain is distributed among a large network of computers. The network is radically neutral. It doesn't matter whether you are a king, whether you are a prime minister, or whether you're a humble, small civil servant. Everyone on the network is treated the same. Now, if you know this, what types of applications can we expect in the future that adhere to this philosophy? But the type of applications that we will see in the future are distributed autonomous organizations, or DAOs for short. A DAO is an organization with no single point of decision making. It is open, it is inclusive, it is ruled by machine consensus, and it is not ruled by a select group of people. The first DAO was created in 2008. The Bitcoin was a DAO because there is no Bitcoin company. There is no Bitcoin executive. If you would like to update the Bitcoin network, you need to reach consensus. You need to go to forums and you need to discuss what will be the next update that we are going to implement. And only when 70% of the computers or 90% of the people vote for a particular proposal, then this proposal will be implemented in the network. So, if you think about DAOs, think about applications like a Facebook application without a Facebook company or without a Facebook executive. Think about a YouTube without a YouTube company. Think about investment managers that is managed by the whole community and not by a small set of fund managers. And think about autonomous cars owned by a community and not owned by a single party. So as a closing remark, I would like to say that we have a very bright future ahead of us. I really believe that with blockchain, we will create a world that will be much more democratic, much more decentralized, and also much more equal. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.